Behind the scenes, it's UK Nigerian entertainment. Actors, models, artists, producers, directors, dancers, watch behind the scenes. You have the green light to go into UK Nigerian entertainment. Let behind the scenes guide.
In the Nigerian and UK entertainment scene, the word legendary is often thrown about loosely these days. You get legendary producer, legendary fashion icon, and legendary this and that. Today, BTS sits with a true legend, DJ Abaz, to chop up the groove theory of the UK and African Afrobeats. Stay with us. Behind the scenes, this place, my man, it's Ben T.
Everybody steady in honor, everybody shaking in honor, everybody setting in honor, everybody doing honor.
DJ Abaz, thanks for having us.
Lace, my man, can I call you that?
Yes, please. Yes, please. I like the way, every time I hear that name, I like it.
That's where we started.
DJ Abaz, I'm privileged you found the time to host us, because you are the beginning, you are the middle, and I don't think you're the end of this game, but you definitely started it.
Oh.
You know.
No, I didn't.
Okay.
I'm always very wary of how to take receive accolades. And it's always pleasing when you hear people say nice things. That was a fantastic intro. I think that would buy credit from my wife for a while. And thanks for the kind words. But the Nigerian entertainment scene in the UK has been flourishing for a while.
But I want to take you back to prior to it flourishing. You were around when we weren't enjoying so much African production. We were still in the Western. We're still in the Western culture. Were you around then?
Yes, but I'd like to also pick it up from us as diasporans in the UK.
Okay.
I was born in this country in the 60s, in 1968 to be precise.
Oh my God.
And we have a generation of our parents,
yeah,
who at the time would come over to the UK to study.
Yes.
And go back. A lot of them had children. Some went back with the children, some children stayed. And they entertained themselves. Also with Nigerian entertainment.
Sounded like my story.
No, at the time, in the 60s, you know, so you had all your big bands, they'll come over. And have shows in the UK.
To entertain the parents?
Yes, in the 60s. You had your Sonia Days, you had your Ebenezer Obeys, and they had many halls in London that come at the time. And they were not as lucky as we are today.
That was the Fela was the problem in that era.
Not even Fela. I'm talking King Sonia Day.
Yes.
Ebenezer Obey, what bands will come specifically to entertain Nigerians in the UK in the 60s.
Okay.
At the time, Fela was studying here and trying to discover his music. Because Fela also went through many phases before he settled on Afrobeats. Fela initially was a highlife artist.
Ooh.
Yes, he was a highlife artist.
Coming out.
And he returned to Nigeria in 73, having been to the UK to come to study medicine. Yes, he has two brothers who are doctors.
Yes.
You know. And left the UK, went to the States.
But you were in DJing at 73.
I was just barely born. So I'm just trying to trace the genealogy that we have always entertained ourselves.
Yeah.
And my story started in 91 when I returned to the UK.
You went to Nigeria, like your parents took
you back. Yeah, took us to Nigeria. Like a lot of us, you know, that were born here at the time, and some of us at a point in time decided to come back to the UK.
Yeah.
And when I came into the UK, there was a thriving entertainment scene. You had Nigerian clubs as far back as the 80s, clubs that Nigerians were going to hang out with Nigerian DJs playing at the time in this UK.
I know, but what were the DJs playing in 1980?
There were, skips my mind now, but you had DJs at the time, guys like Echo Mix. You had guys like DJ King.
They were playing Nigerian stuff?
Yep, you had guys like Dayo Asoloye. You had guys like Ron Ekundayo in this UK.
Entertaining
Nigerians.
But was this a niche market at that point?
For Nigerians, yes. in the UK.
Yes.
So we need to acknowledge them. When I came into town, the two biggest DJs in 91 were Dilly Adelegon and Casey. Mm. You know, and they were guys that truly inspired me, because I knew in Nigeria at the time that were these guys in the UK, and remember they all honed their skills in Nigeria, yeah, and came over to, I think Dele came in 89 and Casey came in 90. I came in 91.
So you know, it was a DJ migration time.
Yeah, exactly. guys were moving in, you know, and obviously when you come in as a diasporan, the first people you look for are yours.
Were we a niche community then in terms of the Nigerian community in the UK?
Well, the way it was at the time is pretty much most communities were very insular. So pretty much everybody kept within themselves.
So we were quite small. Like, how would you describe us at that point?
We had our niche, strong numbers.
Yes, but...
So we all had our... And everything was community-based. Okay. So you want to have your wedding, you need to look for a DJ within the community.
Yeah.
You know? Now, the difference between then and now is like we are almost now fully integrated into the mainstream system. It wasn't that way then. So you were either a Nigerian DJ playing for Nigerians, or you were a Nigerian raised in this country playing within a non-Nigerian circuit.
Did you have enough records at that point to keep a Nigerian party?
As a Nigerian music?
And enough Nigerian music to keep a Nigerian party busy for 4 hours?
Yes. But then at the time, the general taste was for urban R&B, dance hall.
Yes.
And you probably have a little segment of your night where you play, depending on the type of event you're playing,
yeah,
where you play your African music. So primarily Nigerian music at the time.
African music was a minority even in the...
Within the African community, yes, at the time.
At the time.
It was.
Were you just in that box, or did you play a little bit in that box and play mainstream all the time?
It was mainly mainstream. It was mainly with Nigeria now. Yes. So you do your R&B, US R&B.
Yes.
You know, you do your reggae.
Yes.
Dancehall.
Yeah.
I think dancehall was perhaps the first outside of R&B and hip-hop. Dancehall came in, you know. So you do all your Buju Bantings, all your Shabarams, yes, all your classics at the time, and old reggae. Yeah, U-Roy.
Yes.
That was a Nigerian vibe.
Yeah.
That was a Nigerian vibe at parties at the time. So I think what you are really interested about is when did the Afrobeat scene kick in?
We're taking you behind the scenes.
Turn from being 10% or 20% to 100%.
I think it was a 10-year period. Okay. And I think the critical period was between 2000 up till 2012.
So the last 12 years.
12 years in between that, yeah. So because the first generation at the time where you had your Plantation Boys, you had Remedies, and they had releases. So you could drop them in here and there. It wasn't enough to sustain a set, really, a full set.
Yes.
You know, but then they were there and would play them. And also at the time, another form of African music that was quite prominent that they would play was Hip Life from Ghana.
That was Ghanaian.
Yes. Yeah. Reggie Rockstone, Freddie Funkstone, and your likes of Amache Dede, Dasebre.
Let me ask, did you... You know, Nigerian community was a niche community. The Ghanaian community, I assume at that time, was also a niche community.
Yes, but the first level of interaction,
yeah,
before it became mainstream, was between Africans.
So you had to merge to get a bigger...
Yeah, so you had sound systems like 90%.
Yeah.
You had sound systems like Black Knights. You had individual DJs doing their thing. And they had started coming together.
Yeah.
You know, so it was first Nigeria, Ghana. I think the first African relationship in the diaspora, right, among the young urban audience was a Nigeria, Ghana one.
Coming together.
Yeah. I used to do a lot of stuff in Ghanaian clubs.
Okay.
To get it.
Yeah.
So that way their music dropped off for me. I have a good friend, Jimmy the Ball-Headed Guy.
I know Jimmy.
You know, Jimmy was the first African DJ I know that really was playing a lot of African music. and he introduced a lot of us to African music, from especially Congolese stuff.
Yeah.
Or your Koffi Olomides, or your General Defiles.
You know your stuff.
No, it's that was it. And at the time, it wasn't easy. You know, and there's no way I would have an interview and not mention some key people like Jimmy the Ballheaded Guy, who committed himself exclusively to African music.
What could you see? What was the visible change between 1991 as a DJ and 2000? When did you notice something has happened and this has happened?
I think by 2000, a lot of people in the Nigerian DJ community started, you know, getting... remember, we're diasporans and we always have an ear on what's happening back home.
Yeah.
So obviously Remedies broke into the scene, you know, Shakomo,
yeah,
you know, and it was huge back home. And I remember the first copy I got at the time was on a tape, on a cassette, and I actually had to burn onto a CD, you know, and that was what was going on the underground scene. Remedies, Mio Shakom, and then we got the full album, and then you had your Plantation Boys come on board, you know, that included Two-Face,
yeah,
Face and Blackface, yeah, and you had your Paul Dairo,
mm-hmm,
Oshorire,
yes,
and it started building,
yeah.
And then remember the synergy between Nigeria, Ghana, you know, those were two strong diaspora communities.
They were
coming together, yeah, and they were doing a lot of stuff together, and there was a lot of musical interplay between both of them, but those communities. And then gradually the Congolese thing came in as well. So I think if there was any Nigerian DJ or African DJ playing within the African community as you know, as early as 2000, perhaps 80% of your playlist would be from those three countries.
And then was it that time you started seeing an all-African party? When I'm in an all-African party, if you go into a Nigerian party, all the music is Nigerian music.
Or no, music. No.
When
it was still, it was still sets.
It was still sets.
It was still sets.
2000.
Yeah, it was still sets. You know, then you play to up to a certain time. Somebody will come and say, "Ah, play some, play some Makossa." You know, what we call Makossa is actually not Makossa.
Yeah.
You know, whether Zouk or Soukous, yeah, but then in Nigeria, where everything that's not Nigerian at the time is Makossa. Yeah, you know, so once you have played Makossa, then you have to go and start going into your...
People started having a taste for
yeah,
their own.
Everybody, Austin David Apartment. London for social or corporate reasons, whatever accommodation requirement you may have, talk to the professionals. Austin David Apartments. Visit our website www.austindavidapartments.com.
And remember, the DJs are the custodians of sound. You know, it's okay, you know, if they like it, you know. So you're doing this party, maybe you're running a club night, and a Zimbabwean lady is having a party on that night,
yeah,
and you booked her into the nightclub and everything. And somebody should come and say, "Hope you have some South African musical or Zimbabwean musical."
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to go and chase, you know. Not many DJs, even at the time, were embracing African music.
Yeah.
So, but then if you're playing a gig that's going to have a substantial African number, now you have to go and chase the music. And so it was that kind of relationship between the audience and the DJs.
DJ.
While we're trying to trace this genealogy,
yeah,
it's just to realize that DJs played a major role. The audience played a major role because they also gave us that access. And from 2000 onwards, it changed. In 2003, I started a music show in conjunction with my friend who was producer at the time and actually creator of the program called Intro with DJ Abbas. And originally, the plan was to do US music and Nigerian music. But very, very quickly after the first episode, we realized that, look, we got to keep this thing African.
At that time, African music was
always 2003.
A standpoint.
Yes, we had our first, you know, TV station, Ben TV.
Yes.
You know, and he gave me a call, my friend Ayosho, and I said, "Oh, Abbas, you know, we have our own TV station now." It was novel, it was new, you know, TV station.
Was Ben TV running from, was that
2003?
That's when they started?
Yep, 2003. Oh, okay. We were one of the first content providers on Ben TV. And it was the only station.
That was prime time?
No, no. It was the only station. Yeah. Not even that was, but it was the only African station.
Shout out to Ben TV.
You know. So, props, you know. Alistair. You know? And just picture that. We had a platform.
Yeah.
Everybody was watching Ben. Everybody was watching Intro.
Not just the Nigerian community. Every African.
Everybody. So, I always say, I'm grateful as well, you know, because I've had a lot of good firsts. You know, that was a good first. You know, the first African DJ on an African TV in Europe.
Yeah.
Being seen not just in the UK, all over Europe. No. That was a major head start. You know, I could never pay for that. Huh. How do you equate that? And that's part of why I'm today. Because we're giving people what they couldn't get. Today we take it for granted. You can turn on TV, turn on radio, hear. But at the time, that was one of the few, if not only, outlet for African music.
In retrospect, is that one of your moments of, if you have many moments.
The man, oh yeah, like that was a moment. That was a major moment.
That was a major moment.
It was a major moment for DJ Abbas. Because now we had an opportunity to push our music beyond where we had gotten to at the time. So you could watch 2 hours of unadulterated African music.
It was a two-hour show?
It was a two-hour live show. We were breaking every video. Yeah. We had all the acts. They were in town. They were live in the studio. Name them, we've had them. We'll go to Africa, go to the US to do specials, you know. And it was an absolutely wonderful moment.
Within 2000 and 2012.
Yes.
These other parts of the culture, not necessarily music, like you mentioned, fashion culture. Did they come in and help push the music from a DJ perspective?
Yes. We have the Nigerian corner at the Notting Hill Carnival.
Yeah.
We have 54 African countries. And in the UK, we'll perhaps have, and that's spread between Anglophone and Francophone and Portuguese. But the UK is Anglophone. So we'll probably have about 24, 25 African countries that celebrate their independence events every year.
Yeah.
And that was always a platform to showcase all these things with the music, the fashion, the food, and everything just started tying up, you know. Then at the time, you know, initially everybody was doing their own thing, but then the younger generation, maybe we the older generation, were a bit more cautious in terms of mixing with other cultures. But the younger generation, through school, mixed much quicker.
I'm coming to that. But before I go into, because the pressure of the younger generation to move the African entertainment forward is evident. Yeah. You know, we can all see it. But You started it. You saw everything happen just before your eyes, you know. And today it's split into Nigerian entertainment, you know, it's Nollywood, Gollywood, you know, you got Afrobeats and stuff. But we're going to talk just about Afrobeats. We're coming more recent now, you know. You understand the term UK Afrobeats.
Yes.
What happened? You seen it all. You saw another thing coming. What is UK Afrobeats? When it started becoming, when you started hearing this term?
I think UK Afrobeats is a term that originated in the UK to describe urban African music.
African produced from UK or?
Whatever. It could be from back home. Anything influenced by urban African music. And let's not forget, 99% of content we call Afrobeats in the UK today originates in Africa.
Yes.
You know, 99%.
Everybody doing oh no. Everybody standing oh no. Everybody shaking oh no. Everybody stepping oh no. Everybody doing oh no.
In the UK, we had JJC,
yes,
who at the time was signed to Sony Music.
Doing Afrobeat?
He was doing Big Brothers. He had a group Big Brothers.
Big Brother, I remember that.
But then he created the group JJC and 419 Squad.
Squad,
And I think that was 2002, if I remember, if I get my facts right. I think that was 2002. They were performing all over
London.
All over London and perhaps some other parts of the UK at the time.
Yeah.
And we had guys like AY in the UK was a rapper.
Uh-huh.
The first Nigerian rapper in Yoruba that I know.
How were these people received by the Nigerian or African?
They had an audience. That's why they were performing.
They had a great
audience. You know, that was why they were doing something different. we had a band like Sole Crew that I managed at the time.
Yeah.
That included Don Jazzy.
Okay.
And Sole Carmichael.
Yeah.
And that's as late 2001 to 2002. Performing. And Solek was an indigenous Nigerian band, but with a strong Afrobeat flavor
yeah.
at the time. And they were performing live in 2002.
Was it easy for you to, as DJ Abbas, you've always been big from the get-go. You, to me, you're like Jesus Christ. You know, three wise men.
Don't go there.
I'm going to fast forward to maybe just the tail end of 2012. One big factor, is it the numbers? Is it at that time you came in 1991,
yeah.
right? And you started DJing. In 2010, 2012, maybe people were becoming more, the kids were growing.
Yes.
Not just you. Is that the
real upsurge kicked off with the younger audience. Really, the younger audience are very, very important and critical in where we have it today. It was a different audience. You had a university audience, young people, you had newer platforms.
Mm.
You had the likes of Abrantie.
You felt bad when you were in the only one. Did you feel like, oh, these people, everybody, too many people now are not special?
No. you can't afford to feel that way.
I know.
It's impossible. You need to embrace
yeah.
and see, my philosophy is simple. If you grow, I grow.
Yeah.
And it's all about who you helped with your platform. I think DJ Abrantie, who's Ghanaian, had a program on Choice FM. And that's another huge platform. You know, a huge platform. He came in and he was playing Afrobeats on his, you know, we had an exclusively Afrobeats program, and a lot of the younger audience warmed to that as well. You know, and I think if you look at the whole conversation between 2000 and 2012,
yes,
then you'd understand that was the critical period.
Fast forward to the years of action,
mm-hmm.
it's now helped us to push African culture to our children. Yeah. They become proud. They become, yeah. you know, in the future, what do you see UK? What do you see Afrobeats, not just UK Afrobeats, doing for the community?
Well, remember, we're a diaspora community, and the single most important thing that most diaspora communities look for to is into full integration, to be accepted as part of the system. So what stops us from having an African Prime Minister in the UK? Nothing stops us from doing that.
Afrobeat might help us, though.
You know, it has helped start that movement first in terms of identifying with what is ours and appreciating it.
Yeah.
When we came into this town, many were not cool to be Africans.
At the time,
the dominant black culture was Caribbean. So you either had dreadlocks, had gold teeth, or speak with patois. You know, that was it then. But then we've seen all of that change,
mm.
you know, from accepting and being cool, our slangs, our food. And it's an upward trajectory. It always moves on and it gets better.
For viewers at home who don't know, we've been trying to catch up with DJ Abbas for a long time. I'd say 7 years just going through security, you know. We finally made DJ DJ Abbas.
Pleasure. It's been, my man. Always a pleasure.
Pleasure. DJ Abbas has said it. Nigerian entertainment is on an upward trajectory. We're in the House of Parliament. We're MPs. We're everywhere. Wherever this music could take us to, we're going there. It all started with this man back in 91. Been emotional. It's BTS.
W-I-E-B, so behind the scenes. It's UK Nigerian entertainment.
Tell me why he be. So tell me why he be. Oh, yeah, go. Tell me why he be.